e-discovery is discovery and discovery is e-discovery. We don't really live in a world that's not digital. One thing when I first got into the industry that I noticed is everybody always talked about paper. They always wanted to talk about when discovery was paper and they needed to scan it. And I walked into more or less of a paperless industry, and I thought it was a dangerous paradigm, because if you think of documents in a database like papers in a box, you miss out on a lot of the benefit of having them in a database. A database is relational, it's not linear. And that is an entirely new way of viewing a document repository. In the same way, going forward, AI is changing the way that e-discovery is changing the paradigm of e-discovery. So instead of thinking about document repositories in terms of this document with the four corners of the content, we need to be thinking about the stories and the data and the best way to connect those stories through context-aware AI that can understand entities, connect the dots for you, look into the database and understand there's something unusual going on here. As an engineer and a driver of the efficient use of money, it doesn't make a ton of sense to pay for your most expensive, highest performing assets, which is human eyeballs on documents, to look through that 80% of the stuff that ultimately doesn't change the outcome one way or another. And maybe you can apply the 80-20 rule there and say 20% of the documents count and 80% of them are sort of technically relevant, but not super substantive. And so I saw early on in the process that the AI could help facilitate the split between what's important and what's not. It could help bubble the cream to the top. And then the eyeballs could look at the documents that matter, and they could trust the system for the documents that didn't. And so there's always a challenge in the e-discovery industry. Every time we think that something's gonna be automated, there's always the next frontier of challenges that we need to figure out, whether it's technical, whether it's project management, whether it's legal. And so as this AI becomes much more integrated into these tools, our team takes on more of an advisory role, more of a consultative role. This is the best way to apply the AI for your case. This is the best tool. You have a few options, like, they're like your waiter, like, well, our menu has the following 20 options, but a very popular dish is the steak, right? Of course, if you're a vegan, also, you know, the tofu crumble is wonderful too, right? And that's the role that my team takes on, more than becoming nuts and bolts sort of technicians. They're much more consulting oriented. And simultaneously, they're figuring out that next frontier of data and figuring out how to incorporate those into the tools. And so the art of listening and really hearing someone is understanding these questions and asking questions so that you can understand the real trade-offs. Like, what is ultimately, when they have to choose, what is the really important thing to them? And in AI and e-discovery specifically, that's a very important skill set, because you often only get one shot at pitching your AI solution, and you have to do it right. There's already enough hurdles. There's already enough reasons for them to say no. It's risky and it's new and they don't understand it, and they have other things that they want to focus on and prioritize. So if you really listen and you really hear, then you can position that pitch in such a way that it's most likely to be successful, and you're going to speak to what they care about. People don't care what you know until they know that you care. And so listening and understanding what they need before pitching that AI solution is to me just very important for adoption. So I finally got on Instagram, and it was so stressful for me. I was like, I just wanted to look like Google Photos. And that experience sort of, it gave me a lot of sympathy for my clients.